postdoc at JPL, and Marie will be talking about speckle suppression for coronagraphic observations with JWST. All right, go ahead, Marie.
Hello, I'm gonna share my screen.
Looks good.
Great.
If you, yeah.
Go to the presenter mode. Okay. All right. Can you hear me well?
Yep, sounds good.
All right, so thank you and thanks for having me today. I'm a recent hire at JPL working as a technologist on the Woman Chronograph instrument. But today I'd like to talk about research and technology development project that was funded as part of the fiscal year 2020 at JPL. This project is called Speckle Suppression for Coronagraphic Observations with the James Webb Space Telescope. And the idea of this project is to further develop the technique of post-processing based on a model of instruments that I developed a couple of years ago as part of my PhD project, and to implement this technique on JWST. So I'd like to acknowledge my collaborators, in particular Alexandra Greenbone. This idea to apply this technique on JWST was an idea from that came from a discussion from both of us. And also I'd like to acknowledge Charles Beschman, who supported the idea since the beginning, and also Michael Meyer, and Greta Rocha, who is the PI at JPL. So depending of what is your background on exoplanet imaging, you may ask, why do we need post-processing in the first place? How do post-processing techniques work? And why a model-based technique? So why bother with that kind of technique? So during my talk, I'll cover those questions and I'll show some preliminary results of the implementation of a model-based technique of post-processing for the waveform for construction of James Webb Space Telescope simulated images. So the goal of high contrast imaging is to observe the very faint circumstellar environments of close by stars, including disks and planets. This is an extremely challenging task because the contrast of flux between a star and a planet is very high, and it can range anywhere from 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 10, depending on the system we want to observe. And this is why some ingenious astronomers invented an optical device called a coronagraph that blocks the light from the star while preserving the photons of the planets, the faint signal which is in the vicinity of the star. So, however, on this image from the HST from the HRT799 system, we can see that it is infinitely not sufficient because a lot of residual starlight remain on final image, preventing the detection of faint planet signal in the vicinity of the star. And this is why our ingenious astronomers had the wonderful idea to use post-processing to remove the residual starlight. So those post-processing techniques consist in calibrating the speckle field or residual starlight using the image itself or an image of a reference star. And in this example, a target star with a companion is observed with a coronagraph, and a reference star is also observed in the same configuration to obtain an image of the residual starlight that is subtracted from the target image, and to finally obtain the image of the planet. And those techniques are entirely dependent on the stability of the instrument during the observations and how the data at hand captures the instability of the observatory. So this, in the case of an unstable observatory, there will be residuals from the starlight. And most of the time, those residuals prevent the detection of faint sources close to the star, which is a problem. So here, this is well illustrated by the example I showed before of the HRT 799 planets observed with the Hubble Space Telescope. A simple subtraction like the one I just described was performed back in 2004 when the data were taken, but this technique was not powerful enough to detect any planets in the image, unfortunately. So instead, we had to wait 5 to 7 years before applying some more advanced techniques of post-processing to make use of entire libraries of reference stars taken with the Hubble Space Telescope to better capture the state of the observatory during the observations. And applying both techniques finally enabled astronomers to obtain the image of this multiplanetary system, which is the first multiplanetary system that has been imaged ever by Keck in 2007, unfortunately. This could have been a wonderful Hubble discovery back in 2004. But because the team who took the data did not have the adequate tools to process their data at the time, this opportunity was missed, unfortunately. So you're gonna tell me, now that we have those state-of-the-art techniques, we're good, right? Well, actually, not really. Those techniques might work well at large separation from the star. Here you can see, while looking at the image, I cannot point with the mouse, but at the image from 2011, we can detect pretty well the planets that are further from the star. But where we have still a lot of residual star from closer to the star, where we expect the majority of undiscovered planets to be. And the photon noise limits is not reached yet at those separations. And even though processing techniques enable a great gain on the achievable contrast, there is still room for improvement. In particular, those techniques require costly observing strategies that don't preserve the planet flux as well as with a simple classical PSF subtraction, and also they need to be finely tuned. So post-processing techniques are not perfect, in fact, but there are other information we can potentially use to inform the processing of those data. We have a pretty good understanding on how images are formed by an instrument. Here it is a simple model of instruments and its associated PSF. Then we can change the pupil here and show the impact on the PSF. And similarly, we can add some instrumental aberrations and see the impact on the PSF. So this process is completely deterministic, and then it is possible to estimate the instrumental aberration by looking at the data directly. This is called phase retrieval. And so yeah, here it is an example of a model that can be used to simulate high contrast images. And this model is the sum of three terms: the starlight, the residual starlight, also called speckle field, the image of the circumstellar environment, and some noise. And we can then estimate the model parameters by minimizing the following criterion, which depends on the model of image formation and on regularization terms that are derived from a Bayesian formalism. And then a minimization algorithm is applied, iterating between the estimation of the instrumental aberration and the estimation of the object. And this technique was successfully applied on the sphere simulated data showed on the left panel here. And in the middle, you can see the planet that have been injected in those data. And on the right panel, the reconstructed image with three detected planets over the four that have been injected by implementing this technique on those simulated data. But there is more, because this kind of technique has the huge advantage to offer the possibility to use every single information about the observatory or the astrophysical object that we can have, including the information from the reference sensing system that will be used during the whole JWST mission to align the segmented mirrors And this waveform sensing operation will collect information about the states of the observatory every 2 days in average. So this is an important amount of publicly available data, and there is no plan to use those data for high contrast imaging. So this is why we want to understand how those data can constrain post-processing for JWST. And thus, we designed an observing scenario using NIRCam that includes waveform sensing data and coronagraphic image for this purpose. And also we simulated the evolution of the wavefront for this scenario using the latest knowledge about wavefront evolution from ground-based commissioning. And the top panel on the right represents the solar pitch angles for our targets, while the bottom panel represents the total evolution of the wavefront drift in red, which is a combination of three different terms, the thermal, frill, and instrument electronics. And interestingly, the wavefront varies quite a bit by 4 to 5 nanometers RMS from the beginning to the end of the observation. And you can see on the left some example of simulated wavefront maps for this observing scenario at different times, 2.9, 4.4, and 6.6 hours after the beginning of the observation. And now that we have a complete observing scenario and realistic wavefront drift simulations, we can start implementing the model-based post-processing technique to reconstruct the instrumental aberrations. And here we have some NIRCam-like simulated images with a wavefront map generated using 35 Zanicki coefficients, and we performed three different wavefront estimation. In the first estimation, there is no noise in the simulated image. And in this case, we can see that the Zanicki coefficient are perfectly estimated with no difference at all with the simulated coefficients. Second, in presence of noise, the estimation is greatly perturbed, as we can predict. And in this case, we assume we don't have any prior information on the wavefront. And we can see that greatly perturbed when we compare the estimated coefficient to the simulated one. But if we add some prior information from the wavefront sensing data, for example, assuming we know the wavefront error budget, like we did in the third estimation, we are actually able to improve the quality of the reconstruction and decrease the difference between estimated coefficient and simulated coefficient, as you can see on the bottom panel reconstruction, even in the presence of noise. So those preliminary results are thus very exciting, and we are now ready to perform a complete test for the observing scenario we designed. So to conclude, we designed a complete observing scenario with NIRCam data that includes wavefront sensing operations. We implementing the framework for simulation of the complex observing scenario and simulated some realistic wavefronts for this particular scenario. We finally demonstrated a first estimation of 35 Zanicki coefficient from NIRCam-like images. And we are now ready to implement the full Bayesian framework, and we will simulate more and more realistic data as we go to get ready for the validation on real data when JWST is launched next year, hopefully. That's it. Thanks for your attention. Take any question.
Thank you.
Awesome talk. We have a question in the chat from Jason Wong. Is it possible to apply this phase retrieval technique on HST data also?
Yeah, I don't see why it will not be possible to do that. It's completely possible to implement this technique to any kind of instrument as soon as we have a good understanding of the model of instruments for the telescope that you want to apply the technique. So that's the the big work that we are starting to do for JWST in advance of the launch, so we get ready and we don't lose time for the very short mission, which is the baseline of 5 years. So that's very short. So we need to move very fast if we don't want to miss any good opportunity with JWST.
Gotcha. And Rob has a follow-up on that and wants to know if this could also be applied for Roman CGI data as well.
Oh yeah, I'd love to apply to Roman data as well. And so that's something that I've been thinking a lot about in the past, and also I will think in the future. And one of the lessons from this particular project on JWST, I hope, is that we will understand how to apply this technique on chronograph for Roman and also future big flagship telescope such as Louvois or Abex, for example.
Awesome. All right, well, we're nearing into the trivia session, so let's thank Marie again and all our speakers from this session. Thank you, everyone.